Now we will head on to the last, our keynote speaker, John Zibert, who is the Chief Medical Officer, who will talk about how to be a doctor in 2025, taking all these things into account. What you have to remember is that there will be beers and food just right after, so stay tuned and have a more in-depth discussions afterwards.
Thank you, Christian. I'm super excited to be here today to actually share my thoughts. I'm trained in paramedics, clinical researcher in dermatology and oncology. I've seen a lot of patients. But for the last many years, I've worked in the pharmaceutical industry in LEO Pharma. And then I was offered this position in here to actually make a huge difference for patients out there, to really do what we really want to do in the iLab, and that is to help people achieve healthy skin. I can't tell you how it will be in 2025. So I actually brought in some people that will help me to define that. One of them is Princess Leah. The other one is a dermatologist from Stanford called Justin Koo. And the final one is a mathematician and AI expert called Eric Schad from Mount Sinai. So you'll meet them in a moment. So when we talk about the future of medicine, I think we need to look at the global challenges that we will see in the future for doctors. One of them is a huge growing total world population. And that results in also an aging developed world population. What is also important to highlight here is that the focus for you guys out there is maybe not the diseases you can see. One of the things you want to focus on is your daily life, your behaviors. You want to live as everybody else. So chronic diseases suddenly become epidemic. And we also know today that's not true. In 2025, they will become pandemic. Diseases like non-communicable diseases, such as diabetes, but that's also including a disease like psoriasis. And I think we had some pretty good questions here today. Is psoriasis dangerous? And I need to emphasize that the disease on your skin is maybe not dangerous, but as Mikael also alluded to, what is important to say is that it's not just what you see in your skin, it is what is happening in your body. It is called and defined as an autoimmune disease, which means that the whole body is reacting upon itself. So what you actually have is a disease that is attacking all your organs in your body. Is that dangerous? Yes, it is. And what we also see is that patients with psoriasis, they have a much higher degree of metabolic syndromes, such as diabetes. When we want to look into the future, we also need to focus on what is it that the patients actually want. And as you can see on the slides here, they want competent advice. They want to be focusing on trusted sources. They want somebody that cares about me. They want to improve, temporize, cure, prevent my problems. And they also want instant access for answers. And they also want the doctors to know me. Can doctors do this today? No. There's simply no time for it. And I think this is a crucial point, and this is maybe where we do see in 2025 a huge change to how we actually practice medicine, and that is that the patient will actually demand to be in the center of their treatment schedule. But how do we do this? I strongly believe that in 2025, as you can see on this one, we will not be just one person out of a many, right? We will not be one person with psoriasis, one person with diabetes. We will actually be the individual person, right? And this will be benefited by all these technologies, as you see here. So it's personal health tracking by wearables. You know that. We all have a wearable, right? Almost all of us. We also have a cell phone. And what is important is that in the cell phone, we have GPS coordinations being sent constantly to Apple, to Google, whoever, whatever system you use. but we also can track tone of voice and a lot of other stuff that is actually passive data that can act as new technological biomarkers for disease. Right now, we can actually, by monitoring passive data, we can actually predict if a person that is previously diagnosed with bipolar disease or depression, if that person will be admitted to the hospital 40 days before it will actually happen. 40 days before, coming back to the biomarkers, who would think that a biomarker could predict that today? There's none. But the technology actually exists to actually be able to do so. What we also have is the medical imaging. There's a lot of improvement in this space that also can allow us to see what is under the skin. So what you see here on the medical imaging picture is actually what is happening under the skin. And easily we can adopt those things to the pictures that we obtain from mobile phones. We all know patient monitoring, all the things about heart rate, saturation, and so forth, is something that is happening already. But you don't need to leave your house. Everything can be done at the home. So that's a part of the home monitoring. Medication adherence. We also heard about small chips that can be implemented into pills to actually track when the patient is taking their medication, or importantly, when they are not taking their medication. This will allow a signal to alert the patient that they didn't take their medication. Pathology. We will know much more about pathology and know how that will correlate to the clinical outcomes. We can much easier quantify disease by looking into new models that actually is maybe being implemented by AI that will allow us a much faster reaction upon disease. And finally, omics, omics technologies. I want to highlight one technology, and that's genomics. We heard a lot about genomics for many years. I think one thing that is super interesting, and that is that whole genome sequencing is now becoming a commodity for patients. What is the price currently to run a full genome chip for one patient? 32 euros. 32 euros. And you'll know everything about your disease, or your body, sorry, and your chances of developing a disease. That is interesting. And finally, all this, to all this, AI can be applied because we will do a lot of analytics in the future that will allow physicians to actually make a much better decision-making process. So let's look into the future. This is Princess Leia. It's an old movie. We all know this movie. But what is happening here is that we do see a hologram of the patient. What if we in the future could dive into that patient and actually dive in and dissect? This is the tumor, this is how it looks like. We'll go back and then we'll actually be able to do that surgery that is needed for that patient. That is the future. The hologram, the avatar of all of you. If that will happen in 2025, I don't know. Maybe that's in 2030. But a lot of things can be applied with the existing technologies that we have today. I already mentioned the cell phone, and in 2021, we estimate that there will be 6.3 billion smartphones in the world. That allows access for some smart technologies. And those technologies that will be applied on those phones, coming back to the previous discussions, are good enough for you guys. If it's good enough for you guys, it will be good enough for the whole world society. And that is the thing. Remember the picture story about Kodak and good enough with the smartphones and the picture technology that they had? What happened? It's simply good enough, and today it's super advanced, right? The question we need to address now is, how can AI assist an actual dermatologist? So for this, we need to look into a study that has been shown a lot in the news. It's from Stanford, and it was published as a letter in Nature last year. What the whole scope of this study was actually, how can we enhance the knowledge of the experts in making an even better diagnosis? Some facts. 1 out of 5 Americans will develop skin cancer. And in US alone, there's 10,000 deaths related to skin cancer, and in particular, melanomas. The cost is huge. Recently, there was a new treatment for melanoma, that was released and approved by FDA, the PD-1s, super interesting drugs, but that's not just the thing. We need to be able to prevent it. And the risk of developing a lethal outcome of your melanoma is very small, 1% over 5 years, if you detect it early and can do something about it. But if it's in a late stage, you only have a chance of 14% to actually survive 5 years. That's a pretty bad prognosis. So what this is all about, it's about early detection and making physicians and you guys aware about something is wrong in my body, something is happening. And also too, as you can see on the left side here, do some preventative strategies for patients in order to prevent melanoma from happening. So what you see here is just how fast a melanoma can go from something that is non-invasive, so not so dangerous, to something that is completely invasive and super dangerous. Just within a time frame of 2.5 years, you actually reach the 14%, as I mentioned before, chance of survival. And what about this guy, right? What about the guy on the right side? Which one is malignant and which one is benign? Which one is a non-neoplastic lesion? Hard to say. So a small quiz for you guys. So we have a top panel here of pictures. Some are taken by clinical photographies, and some are taken by a dermoscope, which is a tool that dermatologists use to actually look closer into the lesion. So the top row represent either malignant or benign. The bottom row represents benignant or malign. Okay, how many believe that the top row is representing malignancy? Very few. How many believe that the bottom row represents malignancy? Oh, it's actually maybe a little bit more. The results are this. The top row is benign, and the bottom row is malignant. This is quite interesting, because that is actually the dilemma that we do see in the clinical space, right? A lot of you actually got it right, that the bottom row was malignant, but I didn't see any, you know, full arm raised, right? It was just like being a little bit hesitant here. I don't dare to say anything. But that's actually the fact of a clinical practice. How do you make the right decision? So currently, what we have as tools is that we have some algorithms that actually allows us, when I say algorithms, I mean clinical decision trees, that allows us to say something is non-neoplastic, so that could be psoriasis, eczema, and so forth, something is malignant, and something is benign. So what the researchers in Stanford did was they included 130,000 pictures, around 2,000 diseases, and then they identified some primary nodes, which was this non-neoplastic, malignant, and benign classes, and then they had some other nodes representing classes that were the secondary diagnose of the lesions. They applied the Google Net Inception V3 methodology to actually identify which lesions could potentially come out in the end as being either malignant or benign, which was the end results that they were interested in. And this Google Net Inception model is based on the more than 1 million pictures and 1,000 picture categories that has been conducted previously in 2014 in the Google competition. The results were pretty interesting. And as you can see on the p-values here, for those that do not know those, p equal less than 0.05 is something that is called significant, and that is where you do have a perfect match. So they did definitely have some signs of something that worked. And what you see here is some graphs, right? It's representing sensitivity, which is the true positive over actual positive found in the study, over specificity, which is the true negatives over negative. The best outcome you can get is 1.0. What you see is that when they try to identify carcinomas, which you see on the left side, they were pretty good. They reach an area under the curve of 0.96. If they want, so that is the more non-pigmented lesions. When you go into the pigmented lesions, which are the malignant melanomas, they also reach the same level, comparing to what is called seborrheic keratosis. And then finally, when they looked at the dermoscope pictures, they were doing a little bit worse, but pretty good, right? But what if they actually took those algorithms and applied them to real world? How would it then work compared to dermatologists in practice? So they included 21 dermatologists, and this is the results. And I have to say here that this was highly skilled dermatologists from the Stanford and Memorial Sloan Kettering, so East and West Coast. And what you see here is the green dots. The green dots are in the area under the curve in all three cases, which indicates that the algorithm was doing better in classifying the tumors than the average dermatologist. However, you do see some dermatologists doing better than the algorithm, but that was unfortunately only the few. The question is then, can AI then be applied to the clinic? And for this, I think we should move into Justin Koo and ask him.
I want to close by telling you a little bit about one patient that I saw in the clinic last month. Actually, it was April 17th. And this is a patient I saw in clinic, and this was a spot on the shoulder. And this was a spot I was kind of debating in my head over because I was completely on the fence about this. Something that I said, you know, not quite right, but then when I looked at it with my dermatoscope, I didn't see any features that would suggest to me that this was an early evolving melanoma, but my gut didn't really sit right with my gut. And so I said, okay, this is a perfect time to whip out my iPhone. And I took photos. I took photos from every angle, from different distances, with lighting, without lighting, and I fed it to the neural network. And then remarkably, regardless of the photo, it was pretty stable in the read. And it was pretty adamant that this was a malignant lesion. So that pushed me to biopsy this. I biopsied that it's not, you know, the reason why it's not necessarily such an easy thing to biopsy is this is a relatively large spot. It would leave a scar, and you know, if you don't have to do it, it's not necessarily the best thing to do. But I biopsied it, talked to our dermatopathologist, and lo and behold, she said, hey, you know what? This is really fascinating. This was a really early subtle example of an evolving melanoma. So we caught it at a completely treatable stage. He underwent a wide local excision, and he's not going to suffer any consequences from this. So this was, and this was an example. This was the first example of RAI having clinical impact, and that's why I know the date. It's April 17th, the first time that we made a clinical impact.
And that's exactly what it's about. It's about convincing doctors that AI can actually be used to actually make them even stronger and even better in diagnosing the patients. So yes, in 6 years' time, will AI have its fit in the doctor's world? Yes, I certainly believe so. It's not just about dermatology. It's about all other diseases. I think we should reframe what we're doing today to what we'll see in 2025 as we are doing sick care today. In 2025, I strongly believe that all these data points can be digested by AI, and with support to the doctor's way of practicing medicine, they will be able to recognize patterns much earlier, they will be able to do predictive analytics, and most importantly, they will be able to do a much better decision in deciding on what to do with a given patient. So what is it that the patient can get in 2025? And this is where I believe that the doctors will need to adapt, and I think we'll see that soon. We're seeing it already in countries like China, where the government enforced the whole population to be much more digital with WeChat. And right now we're seeing that more than 1 billion consultations has been done and conducted via what they call online consulting in online hospitals. I mean, the terminology online hospitals, we don't even know in Europe or US, right? It's happening already in China. And what they call the hospitals that we see in Halle and so forth, they're not super hospitals, they are offline hospitals. Interesting. Can I get the slides back? Thank you. What we also will get is predictive care that leads to a much better prevention strategy, which will lead to self-care. Coming back to the thing about the melanomas, so patients can be much more alerted about it, and they will be able to actually put on sunscreens at the right times when it's needed. Precision medicine will not just be biomarkers as we know them today, biological biomarkers, it will also include the digital biomarkers. We all know the study that did show that the height rate variability measured here and published in February was exactly correlating to glucose levels in patients with diabetes mellitus. Interesting. Heart rate variability correlating 100% with the systemic blood glucose levels. That's AI when it's super cool. Patients do not need to make a finger prick anymore. They can just look at their watch and have an idea on what their glucose levels are at the present time. Health promotion and impact on workforce. So if healthcare will come much easier, we will also be able to actually spend more time in the workforce. And most importantly, I think, and that is also what Christian alluded to, that the technologies in 2025 will hopefully help develop world access, and in particular in the third world, to healthcare. There are some challenges. I listed them here. I don't want to be pessimistic, I want to be optimistic, but there are some things, and we already discussed that for the last hour, so I will not go too much into it. The only thing I want to highlight is also, as Thomas alluded to, is the adoption. How do we ensure that clinicians and patients, they are trusting in the AI? And I think that's a super important part here. And how do we also include patients? And most importantly, if we want to adopt it into the healthcare system, how do we get it into the IT infrastructure? I think those are the three main points that we need to focus on. So the key takeaway, before we are listening to Eric's chat, is that AI, in my opinion, will enable preventative and precision medicine initiatives, improve patients' experience, access, and outcomes, augment the intelligence of the clinician, make them more intelligent, and remove non-value-added work. And it will also allow the doctors to know their patients like never before. We will hopefully soon move into this disruption phase that we all are hoping for. We are on the tipping point right now. We are trying to get the recalcitrant doctors, the doctors that are not quite open for this initiatives, to actually be more open and implement these technologies in the future. Hopefully, we will move from sick care to healthcare. So what I've been saying so far is also confirmed by Eric Schad. Let's listen to what he says.
The biggest medical systems in the future are going to own no hospitals. It's going to be devices that are monitoring the lives of millions of patients simultaneously, that's looking to see, do you have the beginning signs of a cancer emerging, to not treat the cancer, but to prevent the cancer from ever occurring. Like that day is definitely coming.
I'll be happy to take any questions you may have. Thank you.
Hi, I am Rene, and I have a startup. And my question is about Internet of Things and in relation, because today we talked a lot about image recognitioning, but how do you think Internet of Things will affect healthcare?
Definitely believe that ambient intelligence will be the future in many aspects. And that is because that ambient intelligence is not only able to detect diseases, but will also be able to maybe treat diseases. So a disease like psoriasis is strongly being affected by light, right? So the sun is good for those patients. What if Internet of Things, ambient intelligence, would simply switch that light bulb to be able to treat me when I'm stage, because it can actually recognize my disease and feedback the right UV lengths that will treat my disease in my face? So I strongly believe that something will happen, maybe not in 2025, but we are definitely on the path. Good?
Yeah. Thank you.
It is shifted off. Anyway, just a fear of something happening, sorry. But anyway, guys, thank you very much. And thank you for listening to these talks about AI. And I think it's very obvious that AI is here to stay. It will play a role in the future. If you're in doubt, go just to take one trip to China and see that this is not something they talk about. This is something that is actually happening. We will have a lot of talks. It will give us a lot of things. We heard about variables. Look at the future. It will also be insightables. You will have something chip under your skin. You will swallow something, and it will give you instant messages about how your body is working and actually maybe even predict whatever, heart failure, things you have, stroke. But anyway, guys, we have there's some food, some drinks. You can stay. You can chat to some of the people, to each other, and just mingle and network. And thank you very much for staying with us. And if you have any questions, we're always here to answer. Thank you.